I've worked in Labrador for many years since the late 1960s, and began working again more in the last few years directly with the community that I started working with in Rigolet, Labrador. And I discovered, much to my surprise, that what was a much smaller community that was kind of like in a sense, a suburb of Goose Bay, even though it's 100 and some miles away, has turned into a real center for activity, research on Labrador Inuit culture, history, heritage, health, and many other things. And as I was discovering that, I bumped into Ashley Consolo just this year and realized that she and a lot of colleagues working with her have been very active over the last few years with a lot of community programming, especially research in collaboration with the community over a wide range of subjects. And we had a chance to meet and discuss a number of things at the Inuit Studies Conference in St. John's this fall in October, and decided that we would love to, present some of the work that Ashley and her colleagues are doing, and at the same time bring Antioch College of New England, Antioch University of New England, which is a graduate school, originally part of the mother Antioch University, but now is direct is in southern New Hampshire, and they are special. They are a graduate school specializing in social science, psychology, and things like that, and so. With Alicia Maltz, we have developed an idea of trying to join these two groups, Ashley's group and Alicia's group, and the Smithsonian's activities, and maybe some others. And so to do that, we thought it would be really great because Ashley's work broadly is of concern and perhaps might create some synergy or at least expand the audience of what's happening in Labrador to the larger Arctic region, including Alaska. And I've asked Aaron Kroll to be with us today since he runs a program that has a lot of capabilities in the museum heritage areas as well. So we want to start off with Ashley, and she's prepared some slides and will give us a bit of background about what she's been doing, and we'll have some discussion. So Ashley, thanks so much for coming and providing some materials for us to look at and talk about. So welcome.
Well, that's great. Thanks for the warm welcome and thanks for having us. And I also want to acknowledge that Ina Shywalk is here, who is actually the on-the-ground coordinator in Rigolet, who runs the research and digital media lab there. Ina, do you want to briefly introduce yourself?
My name is Ina Shywalk, and I'm the project assistant with the My Word Storytelling Digital Media Lab in Rigolet, underneath the Rigolet Inuit Community Government. And I've been here for the past 5 years, working with youth and elders and people in our community to capture stories about our past and concerns about our future, and any of the research that happens in our community. I mainly deal with all the researchers, and so we've done like food security, mental health and climate change, water testing, and just recently we did a whiteboard video with the youth about the water quality and how people should keep their water buckets and containers clean. And the most recent project that we also did was a Culture Connect program where we take youth and mentors and they learn a cultural skill or activity that's important to our community.
And also because Ines is too shy and humble to say, last week she was just awarded a huge award in Canada, and it's the Inuit Recognition Award, which one Inuit researcher a year is chosen to sort of celebrate research leadership, and she was this year's recipient at the annual ArcticNet conference, which is a huge honor and a recognition of all the work and leadership that she's been doing in Rigolet, but also through Nunatsiavut and across the north in Canada. And actually internationally, because she travels a lot talking about her work as well. Yeah, so I'm Ashley Consolo, and I'm the director of the Labrador Institute, which is a branch of Memorial University. We're the only university within the province of Newfoundland and Labrador. And this branch of the university has existed in Happy Valley, Goose Bay, Labrador for about 40 years. So we're a research and education and increasingly policy influencing organization that I sort of describe to people as by the North and for the North. So we're a branch of Memorial that brings the resources of a university up into a northern environment, but specifically focuses on the needs and priorities of people living in Labrador, and then sends those needs and priorities back to Memorial, as well as across the circumpolar north and across Canada. So what Ines and I are going to be speaking about today is kind of the overall work that's been done in Rigolet and in Nunatsiavut, but with an emphasis on kind of the idea of health sovereignty and how the work that the community, and particularly under Ines's leadership, has been trying to take back control of not only the research, but also health, and redefining what health means for the community and from an Inuit perspective, and doing that through research that is under their leadership and under their guidance. So just as a quick overview, for those who may not be familiar as much with the Canadian North, there's four regions in Canada that represent Inuit Nuningat, which is considered Inuit homelands. So you can see all the way on the right-hand side of your screen is the Nunatsiavut land claim settlement region, which is in Labrador. And there are five communities in there, which is what we're going to speak about today. But across Canada, there's about 60,000 Inuit, primarily living within these 55 communities that you see here. And all are remote and coastal. And the majority of Inuit continue to rely on the land for hunting and fishing and trapping and foraging and all aspects of health and well-being. So these communities are still very active in land-based activities. I'll turn this over to Ines to talk about her beautiful homeland.
Well, with the Nunatsiavut, it means our beautiful land. So in Rigolet, we have a population of about 300, but you can also see Mokovic, Poso, Hopedale, and Nain. A lot of our people rely on seasonal work, too. Some, we do have some full-time work in our communities, but our communities are all remote, and so we only have, we have access by year all year long. During the summer, we have a coastal ferry that runs from about June until about the first part of December. And then during the winter, people also use Skidoo to go between the communities to visit and to shop for groceries that we necessarily can't find in our communities. We have, most communities have one local grocery store. And we just enjoy our communities.
Ines, this one's yours too.
Really? So with all the research that we've started, it's been more or less we focused on Rigolet, but there has been a few things where we've done, where we've gone through all of the communities, where we've done physical and mental health and well-being, and this is dealing with how climate change is affecting mental illness, and then, but mainly in Rigolet, what we focused on is water quality and food security. So what we've done is we've taken, we've done water testing. There's a few people in our community that like to drink from the local brooks and don't really trust tap water as a source, as their main source of drinking water. So we test water in the summer from whenever the snow is done so that we can access these areas. So it's probably about June till about the October 31st or so. And then the food security one that we actually did in Rigolet was based on looking at what people were eating from the store, and during the year we did it in during months when we knew that there was probably a, we were getting close to the end of the food and waiting on new shipments to come in, or when it was the freeze up time, we did that sort of thing. The gastrointestinal illness, we actually did surveys in the community where every household was surveyed to see how AGI affected their household and what they thought might have been the cause, if it was tap water, if it was something they ate, or if it was something that they were diagnosed with some kind of illness, but we took all that into account. I also mentioned about our Culture Connect program that we do. It's where we take five youth and five mentors, and the youth get to learn a cultural skill or activity that's important to our community. and they learn from each mentor, and as they go along, they learn something that they may not have learned from somebody, like from their parents or from going to school sort of thing? Is that the sort of thing you would get in school? And most of the people in our community, we, if we see something that's wrong, we adapt, or if there's something that's not working right in our community, we adapt to change. So we're learning how to adapt to different things that are happening in our communities.
And that's the beautiful community of Rigolet, where Ines lives. So one of the things that that we look at, and one thing that the communities have made really, really clear in any of the research that we're doing around health or environment, or linking any sort of culture or heritage, is this understanding of the colonial legacies that have come before. Rigolet and the Nenasiavut region has experienced some of the longest running European contact with Inuit communities in Canada. They were the first communities to experience the colonial legacies that have come out. And since then, as with other Indigenous communities in North America and across the circumpolar north, there's these long-standing issues that tie into physical and mental health, particularly with intergenerational trauma, just increased drug and alcohol usage, and other health outcomes. So a lot of people that we worked with, they said, you know, if you want to understand how all of these other pieces tie out with climate change and with health and with mental health, then you have to understand what's come before, but then also realize that it's not being stuck in the past or only identifying by the trauma or by the negativity, and to really focus on what Ines was just speaking about on the last slide around the resilience. And the strengths and the cultural pride and the wisdom and knowledge that can come from connecting, further connecting back with culture and pulling strength from there. Just to give you a sense too, because we're going to talk a little bit about how the climate and environment is changing, the North Labrador Sea and where Ines's communities are is considered one of the fastest changing regions of the Canadian North and across the circumpolar north. And you can see this is data that actually someone from Goose Bay is working on for his PhD, where they're taking the climate data that exists at the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, and they're applying it to this region. And you can see where the high-range emission scenario is sort of business as usual if we continue on as is with no change right now. You're looking at, by 2100, a potential 8 degrees Celsius average change. Right now, the estimates in this region are about a 2 to 3 degrees Celsius average change already. And the North Labrador Sea, according to the U.S. Sea Ice Monitoring System, has lost 73% of its sea ice coverage since they've started monitoring. So it's in a very rapidly changing, rapidly warming environment, and this has impacts for all aspects of Inuit health and well-being. So I'll turn it over to Ines so she can talk about the land.
Sorry, I'm just trying, my computer is about to die.
Plug it in.
For us, when we did our interviews for the mental health and climate change aspect of it, a lot of people had said that the land is where they go to heal and feel well and that sort of thing, but we also had one person say that going out on a land is like going, is his government. It makes him feel at peace, and it makes him feel like he can do anything and nobody's going to be there to tell him what to do. So being able to connect to the land, to being able to go out on the land, is very important in how we deal with situations in our life, such as stressful moments or as, or if it's a place where we go to feel happy. So being able to get out on land to do anything that involves the land, it makes us feel well, and it makes us feel like we have some importance in our lives, and we're able to just go out and say, okay, I'm free, I can do whatever I want, and I know that this is where my ancestors were, and this is where I'll continue to be.
So a lot of the changes that people have been experiencing in the region are tied to this rapid warming that's been happening in Labrador and across the Canadian North, but Labrador is really considered to be at the front lines of the Canadian Inuit climate change experience. So the biggest one is obviously the sea ice change that people have been observing. But there's also a lot of observations of storm patterns have shifted. So there's often more frequent and more severe storms, and they're coming at different times. The seasonal temperatures, whether it's summer, fall, spring, or winter, are just warmer all the time. You're getting greater fluctuations in temperature, so it could be very cold one day, and then it warms the next day, and then it freezes back. And so instead of getting a consistent cold, you're getting temperature fluctuations. The snow patterns are changing. For those of you who were on the phone a little bit before this started, we were talking about how we have no snow up here right now, but very, very cold temperatures. So it's really unusual. So it's kind of blocking people from being able to get out on Skidoo and get out on the land in the way they would like. People have also seen a lot of changes in wildlife and where the wildlife are. So some of the migration patterns are changing, and also different plant patterns and new species in the region. Ines, is there anything else that I've missed in that?
No, I think you've covered it.
Okay. So as Ines was saying, when we were talking to people about, you know, what makes you healthy, how do you define health, what does health mean from an Inuit perspective, what do you think well-being is, everything came back to the land. And everything was foundational to the land. And so Ines had mentioned about this freedom and this sense of healing that happens. And this is one of our favorite quotes on this slide where someone that we had worked with said, you know, if people can't go out on the land, they don't feel like people. And that really shows this intrinsic need from a physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual side to be out there and to continue to connect, as Ines said, with your ancestors and with your culture. But also to be able to support your family through harvesting country foods and to be able to support your own health through being out with the fresh air and exercise and just the overall sense of peace and connection that happens when you're out there. But what we're seeing from climate change and from people's inability to access the land as often or as safely is there's a lot of emotional responses, and I'll let Ines give some examples of what she's seen and heard in the communities.
Excuse me. For a lot of the people in the communities, they're finding that if they're not able to get out on the land, there's a lot more depression, there's more stress in their lives, there's probably a lot more of drug and alcohol use within our communities, because we can't do the things that we always thought we would always be able to do. So just being able to, say, go to your cabin for the weekend, and if you can't get to your cabin for the weekend because the weather has turned bad or you're unable to go due to family problems sort of thing, like we find that there's more stress and people are distressed about like all of these things that are happening. So it's a big concern within our communities that we need to find ways to help people to understand that you might not be able to get out on the land, but there is something else that you can do in our community to help with this health problems that will make you feel better.
Yeah, and a lot of people too. I mean, it was really interesting when we started to do the research. It was focused around climate change and health in general. And there was, you know, whatever age group, whatever gender, we were talking about these emotional responses and the mental health responses were the most prevalent ways that people were experiencing the changes that they were going through. So many emotional responses. And one that was very interesting, in addition to what Ina spoke about as well, is a lot of people were having these grief responses where they were grieving sort of the change in the land and the life, but also anticipating future changes and getting very stressed out and worried and concerned about what was coming before it had happened. So there was almost this anticipatory stress and distress that was emerging as well. Another thing that was connected to that, people talked a lot about when they didn't have the ability to go out on the land and to fill their time with hunting and with healthy activities, that there was often a sense of empty time and often a sense of not knowing how to fill that empty time. And with that also came people who had previously used going out on the land as a way to support their mental health and their resilience and their healing, that was taken away as well. So you have people with empty time and also people who are struggling with other life challenges or mental health challenges. So a lot of people self-disclosed and a lot of health professionals explained that they were very worried about the increase in drug and alcohol usage in the community, and that they were noticing that when the weather was bad or when things were happening and people couldn't get out on the land very often, that there was an increase in the community, particularly with alcohol usage. And then connected to that, there was also a concern that there could be potential increases in suicide ideation or attempts. And this is partly connected to what they've been seeing with the changes over the past number of years, and then also what they know in other regions across the north, where at periods of time in fall when the ice is freezing up and people are can't go out on boat, but it's not yet able to go out on the land and skidoo, and then in the spring where the ice is breaking up and so you're sort of stuck again in the community, there's this... historically, there's been increases in suicide attempts and suicide ideation. And now what you're seeing from climate change is those periods of time are getting longer and mental health issues are becoming more acute. So there was a sense that within within these rapidly changing environmental times, there could be very serious impacts on addictions and on suicide ideation or attempts. But again, everyone was stressing as we can't say that, you know, climate change is causing these things because they're such complex issues that have so many factors involved. But it's certainly becoming more and more clear from people's experience that it is becoming an additional stressor on many, many pathways and aspects of mental health. Another thing that a lot of people discussed, particularly the health professionals we worked with, was the sheer impact of these changing environmental conditions and how it was impacting people on health systems themselves. So a lot of communities, the health positions are either underfilled or not filled at all, and it's the health workers themselves are often overstressed. And many of the health workers in town are from the communities themselves, so they're experiencing their own emotional and mental responses to the changes, and then they're assisting an increasingly large number of people who are also experiencing challenges to that. So it's this sort of double burden that many of the health professionals are facing. And they're also finding that there's more accidental injuries and sometimes deaths with unsafe travel conditions and rapidly changing weather patterns. So they're feeling overwhelmed on that level as well. So I think when we're looking at it from a perspective of health sovereignty, this is one of the quotes from a documentary film that we were working on that we really liked about this idea about if your way of life is taken away from you, then you lose control of a part of your life. And another very prominent Inuit leader, Shilawat Kluche, she talks about the right to be cold. And if you have a culture like the Canadian Inuit and other circumpolar northern communities that are based around having a cultural context of thousands of years that rely on cold, that want the cold, that like the cold, when that's being taken away, then you're actually losing a sense of control over yourself, of your own self-determination, and of your ability to have sort of sovereignty within health and culture. And so this this quote on this we always found very powerful, and it's one of the leads of the project that we were working on up in Nain, and he was the mayor of the Angiukok at the time, and he said, you know, Inuit are people of the sea ice, and if there's no more sea ice, how can we be people of the sea ice? And, you know, in the film he sort of laughs about it, but it's a very profound statement of what happens, you know, if the sea ice is changing so much in this region. How do people move forward with new identities, new patterns of life, new ways of living, and new cultural expressions? So this is a film that Ines and I worked on with the five communities of Nunatsiavut Labrador, which documents, it's about 35 minutes long, and it's not certainly not a flashy film by any means. We were all very novice filmmakers. But it tells the story from 24 different people's perspectives of what the Inuit and Labrador are experiencing and how it's impacting all aspects of their culture, their heritage, their knowledge sharing, and as well as their physical and mental health. And it's available online for free at lamentfortheland.ca or on YouTube as well. But one of the things that we really want to emphasize is, you know, communities are taking control and understand what they need to move forward in these changing climates and these changing times. So I'm going to turn it over to Ines to talk about some programs and initiatives that Rigolet and other communities, but through Rigolet's leadership, have initiated to try to deal with many of the challenges that people are experiencing.
So as I mentioned before, the Culture Connect program we've done in Rigolet for 2 years now, and I think we have another year coming up. And we're bringing youth and youth and mentors. Like, our mentors aren't anybody who is over the age of 65, because we tend to find that a lot of the programming or funding that we do get is for youth and elders. And there are a lot of people between the ages of 40 to 65 who have a lot of skills that need to be shown to youth that they may not know. So we're bringing in these people who are between 40 and 65 who want to teach something to the kids and who doesn't mind teaching to the kids. And this is a way of getting to know people in your community that you might not necessarily meet. You might see them day to day to say hi or wave at them as they're passing you, but to actually sit down and talk to them, this is what we're trying to promote with the children, with the youth, and also with the mentors in our community, because a lot of the mentors today, they don't know, like a lot of the younger kids coming up, they don't know who they are, but they know who their parents are, sort of thing. So this is what we want to try to promote, is connecting youth with mentors who have a culturally appropriate skill or tradition that they may want to teach to youth in our community. And this is a really exciting program that we're starting now. The ENIC program is a land-based monitoring program where it's starting in Rigolet first, and then we'll see how it goes, and maybe we'll move on to other communities in the next few months. But what it is we're giving households in the community iPods, and on the iPod there is being an app being developed, which is the ENIC. And people are able to take their iPods, or you don't need to be connected to Wi-Fi or have internet access when you take it out. People can record what changes they've seen, or if they're out on skidoo and they see a dangerous spot in the ice and they want to record it. So what they do is they open the app, and in the app there's a little pinpoint marker where you dot it on the land or if you're on the ice. And then once you do that, you go in, you record where you're to, or you can take a picture or a video. And we have emojis under as well, where people can say if they're feeling happy or sad. And then once they've done that, they can keep it, and it'll go into a marker. And once they get back in town, it can be uploaded to the central app, sort of thing. And then people are able to access it in town. So if they go on and they say, okay, I'm going to travel this way today, and I want to see if there's anything wrong with the ice or what the going is like, and this, they can click on the marker, and the marker will tell them, like, what the ice conditions are, or if it's a bad place for picking berries, maybe they should go to another spot, or if there's some kind of change there that may not have been there before.
As Ina said, we're really excited about this one. this one is sort of... I don't know, Ines, how would you describe it? Like, the culmination of the last almost decade of research that everyone's been working on and putting it all together into one program.
We're finally seeing something coming out of a program where all the research has been done that we're able to look at and see and say, okay, I don't need to read a 100-page report. I can just go on this place and be able to see what's happening in my community.
Yeah, and what's really neat about this project as well is we're working with computer scientists who have been working with Rigolet to design the code from the ground up. So it's all participatorily designed right from the technology onward, and everything that it's measuring and everything that it's in its design is all from what Inuit in the community want. And then the idea is that it can grow to support the rest of the region and potentially other regions across the north. So we just wanted to leave you with this idea about, you know, Inuit communities, as you can see from everything that Ines was just speaking about, are resilient and are moving forward and are trying lots of new and innovative things to deal with the rapidly changing environment. And a lot of the adaptation strategies are really focused on connecting with culture and with heritage and with Inuit knowledge and wisdom and connecting with the land. But climate change is becoming this additional stressor. A lot of people that we work with actually describe it as another form of colonization, you know, something perpetuated from people who didn't create it and it's now impacting on their lives. But this idea that community health and moving forward is being related to preparedness and how to fit in a new world and a new reality. And so a lot of the things and the programs that are being designed are trying to focus on this, is how do you fit into this new reality and this new world, but fit in a way that still brings all the strengths and beauty and resilience of Inuit culture and of thousands of years of land-based knowledge together. So with that, these are a lot of the amazing people that we work with and the different places that this research has been funded over the years. But we're happy to answer questions, or I don't know how the rest of the session would work, but please feel free to direct all questions at Ines.
Thanks a lot, Ines and Ashley. That's a great introduction. I mean, I've known Rigolet for such a long time, and yet this is all pretty much new to me because I'm there in the wrong time of year. And it's just great to hear all the progress and all the excitement about the work you're doing. So I'd like to invite, you know, any comments we have. I don't know if this is the time for Aaron to maybe mention a few things. There's an awful lot of connections between what's happening in Alaska and some areas. But this is a very interesting focused program in Labrador. And yeah, anybody who would like to have questions or bring up some points, please do so.
Well, this is Aaron Kroll at the Arctic Studies Center in Anchorage, and I just want to congratulate Ines and Ashley on that was a really great presentation. I love your range of programs, and the key is that they're all community-based, community-centered, and have been able to integrate lots of scientific research. I know that takes a lot of time and forward motion that has to be continued over a long period, and it just looks like a wonderful, a lot of great things have come together. And I do, I see that our programs here in Alaska are different. We're, you know, our program is based at the Arctic Studies Centers at the Anchorage Museum. We have wonderful heritage collections here. We do a lot of work, for example, with language learning based on discussions about objects in the collection from the different Alaska Native peoples, and on artist residencies where you have wonderful teachers who make everything from snowshoes to salmon skin clothing here in residence and teaching students and apprentices and producing how-to videos. And those are great museum programs. We do take those out to the communities and have follow-up workshops in those skills. And that works very nicely because there is the connection to the land, gathering materials for those arts, for example, cedar bark for basketry. But I see that, you know, it's very different to have a program that's using museum resources, it's located at a museum, and bringing people into it as a resource center, as opposed to having such a great program built right in the community. And I just wanted to mention, it reminded me, some aspects of it reminded me, especially the local environmental observations of the ILOCA program in the U.S. I believe that's funded by National Science Foundation, but it's hosted by the National Snow and Ice Data Center. That has a lot of very nice programs that are just about local knowledge, everything from environmental change to connections with place name inventories on the land. And a lot of these programs have taken place in Alaska, and then ILOCA is kind of a central way for that to be gathered and available for other people to see. So that's, I don't know if you know about that program, but it's might be interesting to take a look at their site to see some similar things.
Yeah,
but thank you for the presentation.
Thank you. No, we do know about the ALOCA project, and it's a great one, and we've also been in contact with several of the monitoring programs that are happening in Alaska, with Michael Brubaker and the LEO Network and the different things. So a lot of our sort of early ideas, as well as we were starting to develop, particularly this monitoring work, is coming from lessons learned in other places. And we also have an international scientific advisory committee that has people from all across the circumpolar north that have worked in various types of monitoring that are helping this the Inuk app develop and providing sort of a lessons learned from what they've gone through and different things. So it's an exciting kind of opportunity to collaborate with people from all across the north.
Yes, it's great.
Thanks, Aaron. You know, sometime, Tom, I think we ought to tap in Aaron for a program, you know, later on next year, because he'll have some very interesting, you know, other stuff that he can present from Alaska. Anybody else? And by the way, Aaron did have some history in Rigolet, too. He was part of one of our early teams doing work out at Rattler's Bite, Inez. So,
oh, no way.
It was fantastic to see pictures of that place again after, 40 years?
Amazing.
Yeah.
Did it look different?
Yes, it does. Bigger.
Well, it looks snowy.
Excuse me, this is Moses Drapanoff with the Alaska Native Tribal Health Consortium, and I do work with Mike Brubaker with the LEO Network Program, and I'm online here, and I was wondering if it might be possible for Sarah or somebody to put up, or Jessica to put up a new pod and so I could share a screen and kind of show you folks a real quick snapshot of what LEO's doing, the network, and the connections to what the folks are doing, which is pretty amazing.
Sarah, can you do that?
I think so. I am not good at this as Jeff is, but I'm going to make you a presenter. And does it now say share my screen?
Yes.
Okay. I would also note while Moses is pulling this up that Aaron gave a really nice presentation. What was it, about 6 months ago on the museum?
Yeah, that was great. Don Bittison and I both talked about our programs in more detail, and we were happy for that opportunity.
Yeah, and that presentation is available on the website, and so I will put the link to that in the meeting note.
Yeah, I think for Tom and the new health committee and everything, there might be some other kinds of things to stress there too, and it would be a different audience as well. Anybody else have a comment while we're getting a picture up here?
I have it up. Can you folks see my screen?
I can see it.
Yes.
Whenever you're ready, I'll just let me know, and I'll give you a real quick heads up on this.
I think we're ready.
Okay. So what you're looking at here is a community map of all the LEO communities, not only in Alaska. You can see it's in Canada as well as down in the lower 48, Mexico, and in parts of Europe, and so on. But the point I'm getting at here is when you look at this map, it shows you in Yellowknife, for example, the bigger the circle, the more folks within that community are LEO members. And as you can see, in Canada, it's in the British Columbia, Alberta. We have some folks up there in Nuvilut Settlement, but that's about the only regions. And when I go to the past posts, since LEO started, you can see that the farthest north any post came from is here in Yellowknife. Another thing we're doing, aside from there's no folks up here in Labrador and Newfoundland area or Alert, also we have a climate map which I search the internet and look at media reports, and you can see there's a lot of things going on in Canada, including the area you folks that are talking about. It says your ice pack defeats cargo delivery. And this is the accessible via through the LEO network. So you can see where you folks are talking about, there are things going on. But when you get to the LEO network, we don't have anybody in the region, folks that are talking about, that would, from my point of view, I think LEO would be perfect. And the reason I would like to say that, and the hub currently right now is the First Nations Health Authority, and they've got their own website and they're working on it and putting it together. The overall look of the hub, when you look at it, I go to NTHC, let's see here. I want to view this on a map. So, okay, there's a community, stable, NTHC. Once you have a LEO hub administrator, these are the sort of things that you'll be able to have, you will have access to. It has a timeline on the bottom here, tags that are able to help us identify certain things that, observations that need to be posted or reviewed. Up on top, you can see that we have 565 posts just for Alaska, and these would be Alaska members, two in review, one draft, and a couple rejected. We also started a new thing called projects, as well as here are the hub links that we're able to access as an administrator to update information. Looking into projects, you can see all the different sort of projects that we have going on, from ski watch, fish illness, and you can see there's 19 observations. We got the dog tick as well as community and so on. And these are what, like, let's see, I'm looking for one here. Tom Oakey, Dr. Oakey, is a lead LEO for British Columbia, and he's working with the folks at the First Nations Health Authority for their hub, which is this one right here. And you, the folks up in your part of the country up here, would also have, I think, a great opportunity to be able to utilize this tool, which is free, and use it in a way that would help your community better, not only better understand the community and how they live, what's happening and what's changing there, but it also has a connection to human health because of what was presented earlier about because of the changing environment, where people are having to adapt, or I mean, there's things that are happening and out of their control and not sure what to do. This would be a great resource for your folks in that part of Canada, in Canada, to use to help monitor climate events in relation to human health.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you for showing that. You know, it's, we just came back from a big scientific meeting of all our advisory committee, and it was discussed there that we're probably at the time now with our project and with the beta testing and everything to reach out to you guys to talk about moving forward. And so that was one of the recommendations that came out of the scientific advisory committee, is that in the new year, we reach out and look at how we can connect. So it's wonderful that you're on this call, and maybe we can have a follow-up conversation with Ines and the rest of the team sometime soon.
That'd be wonderful.
Yeah.
Thanks.
No, that's great. Thank you, and thank you for showing us.
Mm-hmm.
This is Tom Hennessy from CDC in Anchorage, and Ashley or Inez, I'm wondering if you can comment a little bit on what kinds of observations you're making through the ENUX system that are of value to your community.
I'll let Inez answer that one.
Well, right now the ENUX program is in its early stages, so we've got it to 5 houses in the community that are testing out and trying to work out any bugs or anything that's happening with it. So mostly people have been taking pictures of, like, for the past 2 summers, we've had a lot of rain and a lot of wind. We have, in the community, we have a local food first that's dealing with the issues of food security and all that. But they have a gardening program, and they have mentors and mentorees, and we've seen that the gardening is not as good as it usually is, because, like, I think in the month of July, we probably had about 25 days of rain and wind, and whereas we're probably our better months for doing stuff. So it's like taking notice of that sort of thing people are seeing, and then taking notice of where, like, the better berry picking grounds are that always were really good, but now they're changing.
Okay.
One of the other components that we're working on that is adding it to a different pieces is really trying to map the psychological responses that people are having as well on the land. But a lot of it, as Ina said, is we're in such early beta phases with it that a lot of it right now is to see what the app can do and then what people find missing and what they still want to be able to identify. So before the technology component was created, the community spent about a year discussing what health meant and what the main things were to be looking at. And Ines was actually responsible for a large design component because she came up with the idea of being able to map happiness and map people's emotional responses through the use of emoticons and different things. So that became a main priority, but also looking at the deeper components that people have. So we're trying to track both physical and mental health with it. The other thing that the app does too is if, say, people are indicating that suddenly they're experiencing a lot of frostbite, the information goes to a central location. So health data is private, other parts are public, and those in a health decision-making component can see the trends that start to emerge in the community in almost near real-time scenarios, and then they can start to address it at the public level. So the app is bi-directional, so people put information into the app, but then other people can send information out. So it could be a frostbite, how to treat frostbite information, or it could be a community notification saying, come to this community event. So it's we're developing it based on what the community had indicated that they wanted it to be, this very dynamic piece back and forth. So we're not quite 100% sure how it's all going to come together or how it's all going to be utilized, but at the very least, it starts to get a really active baseline data for everything that people are observing and then experiencing and feeling with it.
Wow, that's really interesting. I hadn't heard of anybody mapping happiness before, but I really like that idea, and it ties in with the other themes that you presented. I think one of the things that we're seeing is a real thirst for being able to link these kinds of local observations and traditional knowledge in a way that's useful for people and that also can be shared across communities. So if there's problems that are encountered in one place and people are finding solutions for those, they might be able to be shared with others. And Moses just gave a really nice sketch of how the LEO system is really evolving and changing and becoming part of that linkage. I think that could help us. In the Arctic Council, there's an initiative that was started just this last 2 years during the U.S. chairmanship on integrating and improving kind of these One Health relationships in the Arctic and thinking about where human health, animal health, and environmental health all fit together and developing more of a connectedness. And I think these monitoring systems like you have for Inuk, and like what LEO has, and there's another program in Alaska called the RAMP program, and Aaron just mentioned another one I hadn't heard of, the ELOCA program, but I think there's gonna be a growth in these and probably a real concerted effort to find a way to share the real gems of these systems and to link them in a way that's helpful for each other. So I'm glad to hear that your plan is to reach out and to find other ways to connect perhaps with LEO, because I think that's where we're going to go with this, so we can share all this good local knowledge and experience in a way that's helpful for everyone in the Arctic.
No, it's any very other, exciting time.
Any other comments from other participants?
Yes, so this is Roberto. I just want to say that I think, yeah, there's a lot of interesting opportunities here. And also some of this work, particularly with those tracking or measurements of happiness and psychological outcomes, is also useful in the Arctic Council initiative that I've been coordinating in the past year and a half, the Rising Sun Initiative, focusing on reducing the burden of suicide among indigenous groups. And part of that initiative goals was to develop a toolkit with outcomes. And we did a broad consensus building exercise and regional workshops, as well as a few focus group discussions. And we're closing out now. We're finalizing the report, or at least the executive summary for the Sustainable Development Working Group of the Arctic Council. And we're seeing that across the different roles of stakeholders, from clinicians and researchers and government officials and community members, that a lot of the interventions, or the outcomes rather, that were prioritized were based at family and community level interventions. And what the next challenge or task for us is coming up with appropriate measures so that we can ensure that these outcomes, in fact, are being achieved and overall help us evaluate any type of suicide prevention interventions across communities. So I'll be very interested in following up with Ashley and Ina and their group in the new year to see how their measures become sort of established and perhaps vetted well in their communities and see how applicable that can be with some of the other indigenous communities that we're working with.
Thank you, Ron, for talking about it. Anything else before moving on? Okay, well, Ashley and Inez, thanks so much. It's really wonderful to have you available to this new group of people in Alaska. I guess you pretty well know what's going on up there, actually, but a lot of us haven't been aware of what's been happening in Labrador. I'm very excited and congratulate you on the program that you've developed. So we'll keep in touch and hopefully we'll be getting together with you later this winter with some of the Antioch people as well. So yeah. Thank you very much. It was a great presentation.
Well, thanks for the opportunity, and thanks for having us.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much.